Just back from the second annual Lifestyle Medicine Conference in Massachusetts, Dr. Betsy O'Neill was the recent guest at the St. Clair Psychiatric Grand Rounds. This is a podcast that is available on the St. Clair YouTube channel, and it's well worth watching for integrative medicine professionals. The topic was how hospitals and smaller clinics can work together, but she also made quite good points about the role and responsibility of integrative medicine professionals, such as learning how to handle your own stress, learning how damaging stress is to begin with, how to be a better example of proper health habits by leading the way of lifestyle, and also the importance of medical professionals to support and take care of each other. Care for the caregivers was a very important topic. So I spoke with her afterwards about just how caregivers can learn to de-stress.
Well, the first step really is just to recognize the importance of it, which I think a lot of people don't spend a lot of time thinking about. And the other thing is just to realize that to have effective stress management doesn't necessarily mean that you have to spend an hour meditating every day. That if you could even just take 5 minutes once or twice a day to do something to relax your mind, that could make a difference in the way you feel overall. So I guess recognizing the importance of it and realizing that it doesn't have to involve a lot of time, and then just the next step would be educating yourself about different ways to do it.
And what about support and support groups and people to turn to? What's the best place you found for that kind of support?
I think for me, I'm lucky in that that's mostly my working colleagues. You know, we do it for each other. When we teach other people stress management, we're getting the benefits of it ourselves if we go through an exercise. So for me, it's easy, but most clinicians are not going to have that kind of a work environment where they're going to be getting that kind of support from their colleagues. And if you talk about like a support group, that's just going to be another thing that people have to do that's going to take up time in their day. So that's probably not going to be really effective for people. I think the thing to do is just seek out those friends, colleagues, family members who do have an interest, who may have some knowledge about it, and just cultivate those relationships so that you feel like you have someone to share ideas with. You know, I tried this, it didn't really work. I tried this other thing, it seemed to work. What works for you? You know.
Mm-hmm. So creating community and finding other practitioners that are interested in that sort of thing.
Right.
So, and I appreciate that you've joined our Integrative Medicine Professionals Meetup group for that reason.
Right.
And you also mentioned that you just got back from Harvard and a conference there on integrative medicine.
It was on lifestyle medicine.
On lifestyle medicine. Oh, excellent. So tell us what's changed from last year, how, you know, what's shifted, how much more accepted is it out there in the big bad world?
I think that this was the second conference that they've had. Harvard now has an Institute for Lifestyle Medicine, and this year was the second Lifestyle Medicine conference that they had for providers. And one of the sessions was inviting people who had been at the one last year to come back and talk about successes that they'd had. So what the organizer of the conference shared with us at the outset, and again at the end of the conference, was that it's already apparent in just 1 year that many more people are interested. There's a lot more energy around the concept of lifestyle medicine, that he's getting a lot more, you know, sort of inquiries and contacts from people who are making this a part of what they do. And there were people who came back from the previous year and indicated, first of all, what lifestyle behavior changes they'd made in their own lives, and then secondly, how they were building programs in their hospitals and clinics. I was amazed to see that, I mean, I know Harvard is a really well-respected institution, but there were people there from all over the world. There were two doctors there from Nigeria, which is a place where I wouldn't really think people had problems with bad diet and, you know, not enough exercise.
Not enough exercise.
But actually, I learned that it's becoming a problem even in the developing world.
Well, I think anywhere there's a middle class, I think you have
this problem. It's unbelievable. Yeah. And so there were people there from all over the world, but, you know, obviously most of them from the United States. And it was just really gratifying to see, you know, primary care providers who were there. And we all shared who we were, where we were from, and why we were there. And a lot of people were there saying, I know that I need to be doing this with my patients, and I know that I need to be a better example myself, so I need to learn some of this for myself too. So I think that's a real shift in medicine, that people are realizing that as physicians they have to be examples for their patients, not just in not smoking, but you know, in having a realistic weight, and you know, being involved in regular exercise and promoting healthy food and doing stress management.
Does there seem to be more acceptance within the medical community of the term lifestyle medicine over integrative medicine?
I think lifestyle medicine is easier for people to understand because it just is what it is, where integrative medicine you have to explain to people. It doesn't tell you right off exactly what you're integrating, yeah. Right? So I think lifestyle medicine is easier for people to understand, and I also think that it's becoming more a part of the awareness of the medical community that lifestyle is a big factor in illness and that we have to find effective ways to deal with it.
Yeah. There are organizations like the Institute of Integral Nutrition, which are putting out hundreds of new health coaches every year. Is there any plan, you know, either formally or informally, for Allegheny or any other doctors you know of to start seeking those coaches out to start to work with them?
Our model is to incorporate coaching in what we do with people because it's really the only effective way to get people to change their behaviors. And so the problem right now is that there's not a reimbursement model for it, so we have to figure out how to make it work financially. But I think our program is going to be based on a coaching model. And hopefully that will be a model that, if it's successful, and we believe that it will be, that then other clinics and other practices will want to emulate. Of course, that will all be easier if it becomes, you know, financially feasible for us to do that kind of work.
Sure. Now, there may be some new opportunities for jobs at Allegheny for integrative medicine professionals. Are you anything you can tell us about that?
What will certainly happen, you know, within the next 1 to 2 years is that we will want to have independent contracting providers who can provide services, because we can't just hire a bunch of people, but we're going to need people who can provide services. And so we would bring people on as independent contractors to provide things like acupuncture, massage therapy, you know, psychology services, and potentially many other therapies too.
Great. Well, we'll hopefully have you on when you can tell us more about all those exciting developments.
That'd be great.
All right. Thanks very much, Betsy.
You're welcome.